Okay, friends, let me introduce myself. I am Puneet Juneja. I'm right now at Ahmedabad. And we will be taking up the topic of consumer protection laws in India. Now, which semester we are dealing with, ma'am? This would be like... Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, which semester we are dealing with right now?
The first year, first semester. Second semester.
First year, second semester. Okay,
ma'am. Yes, sir.
Thank you. So, Consumer Protection Act, as we all know, that with the act which is for the protection of consumers. Now, what is consumer? So, consumer, there is a definition, of course, given under the act, but generally, we all say that, you know, when we go to a shopping mall or somewhere, we all are consumers. And we somehow know our rights as such as a consumer. And everywhere we go, we do assert our rights of being a consumer. So we will take this up from the historical aspect, and then we will come to the latest legislations also in the subject. So, Consumer Protection Act, this came in quite later, but there was, India has an ancient history. And historically, if we trace back, even the old kingdoms and ancient kingdoms, they had certain laws in place for protection of the consumer rights. Manusmriti, which is an ancient Hindu code, which also prescribed the code of conduct for traders. It prescribed the punishments for the offenses which are against the buyers. For example, adulteration, that was defined as mixing one commodity with another and being sold as pure. And then there was also guidance is given under that for selling something which is not of proper quantity or weight, or hiding the details of that thing which is being sold. Now, if you all know, you know, we have very, in old cities, if we go, there are big shops written Desi Ghee, pure Desi Ghee. Now, why this has to be mentioned? If something is pure, it is pure. You don't have to mention that. But then this is something which, you know, catches the eyes of the consumer. So selling something which is, you know, pure, or which is shown to be pure but is not pure, or is adulterated, therefore is an offense. Even there were the punishments which were prescribed under the Manusmriti. The punishment of adulteration, for example, for concealing truth, even for, you know, competence of parties to enter into contract, for protecting the insane, intoxicated persons and aged from the consequences of fraud contract. These laws are under, presently under the Contract Act, we have such provisions. Then dishonesty was also taken up as an offense. And weights and measures were inspected every 6 months, even in those days. And the result of these inspections were duly noted and publicized, that persons who are complying with the weights and measure norms of the time. Then we had the age of Kautilya and Yajnavalka also. Kautilya wrote Arthashastra, Yajnavalka wrote Yajnavalka Smriti. And even in those books or the literature, they had recommended punishment for offenses against consumer rights. There was, penalties for in Arthashastra also there was penalty for a trader who adulterated grains, fat, medicine, perfume, salt, sugar by mixing the things of similar nature. There used to be a position of director of trade who was primary, the primary today was a certain position of trade, director of commerce. So this used to be there even in the ancient kingdoms, and their duty was to take care of the rights of the consumers by regulating the prices, by regulating the wholesale prices, so that the consumers get the proper, they did allow the proper margins to the retailers, and thus the things were controlled through the post of director of trade in the kingdoms. So Kautilya had prohibited cartels in Arthashastra, cartels, black marketing, and unfair trade practice. And even the severest punishments were for cheating with false kauri shells. Kauri shells used to be, as we have currency notes right now, kauri shells, leather, dice, ivory cubes, these used to be currency in those ancient times. So for cheating or for with false kauri shells or leather, dice, ivory cubes, the punishment could be even cutting off one hand. Chandragupta Maurya, he was the disciple of Kautilya, and he implemented Arthashastra. So he implementing the Arthashastra, he even said that what should be the good practices. For example, goods could not be sold at a place of their origin, field or factory, where they are. Even today we have that, directly selling from factories is not permitted in certain laws. We have the market yards where the goods or produce is taken up for sale, and from the appointed market yards only the trade takes place. Then we have the, for everything we have a certain marketplace, and that marketplace is a designated place from the, where the sale, because there used to be a requirement for license to sell. Even if you go to APMCs, there is a requirement for license to sell within the APMC, and therefore everything that is produced had to come to the market, and from market it used to be sold. There used to be a superintendent of commerce who fixed wholesale prices as they entered the customer house, and margin of profit was allowed, and to fix the retail price, and thus speculation and other things were prohibited. Then came the medieval periods. There were sultanates in India. Even they had proper strict checking for weights and measures. They controlled and regulated the consumer markets. They also ensured that the rights of the consumers should be taken care of. During the British period, this English legal system, Indian legal system was revolutionized. We adopted the English legal system. There were important adaptations made on the basis of ancient traditions and customs of Indian legal systems also. And thus, we had the good of both during that period. And there was a system of separate personal laws, dharma and local customs. Even if you know that even the personal laws today, they give due reference to the original local customs which were prevalent. They passed laws like Indian Contract Act, Sale of Goods Act, Indian Penal Code, Drugs and Cosmetic Act, Civil Procedure Code, Agriculture Produce Grading and Marketing Act of 1937. So these laws were for the protection of consumer rights, but they were not specifically for that. But yes, they did take into its periphery all the consumer rights which were. Even if you go into Indian Penal Code, there are provisions for against adulteration, and counterfeiting. The same provisions, even under Contract Act, we have provisions which somehow take rights, protect the rights of the consumers. Sale of Goods Act also deals with the sale and purchase of goods, and some also taking care of the consumer rights. Then post independence, we had laws for prevention of food adulteration, prevention of black marketing, and maintenance of Essential Commodities Act. This Essential Commodities Act is now right now being very often used even in the media, and so because right now, since we are going through this phase of lockdown, this is the law which is being referred to time and again for flow of essential commodities. Then cooperative societies and multi-state cooperative society laws were formed, laws regulating narcotic drugs, psychotropic substances. We had Bureau of Indian Standards established, which, you know, decides the what should be the standard of products that are being sold in the Indian markets. We have this ISI mark. Then we have now Bureau of Energy Efficiency Standards also, which gives you the star rating on your products. We have laws regulating monopoly and restrictive trade practices like Competition Act. We have then laws making objectionable advertisements of drugs and magical remedies. Then we have Consumer Protection Act of 86 and now 2019. Now, Consumer Protection Act of 86. Now, this was the first comprehensive law which provided for mechanism of protection of consumer rights. It was intended to provide justice with less formal, less paperwork, and less delay and less cost to the customer. If you are aware, since you are the students of law, if you have gone to the courts, it takes long time for civil suits and complaints to be proceeded. But this Consumer Protection Act provided for time-bound remedy. Yes, we are not right now being able to, adhere to those time limits which are given under the Act. But it still does provide for a less formal way. You do away with the Civil Procedure Code. You do away with the laws of evidence, which require, production of evidence in a proper formal manner. And even the cost to the consumer to go to court is very less, because the court fees as compared to the civil suits is very less in Consumer Protection Act. Then it provides a flexible legal framework, wider jurisdiction, and inexpensive justice. One can file a complaint under find in CPA a mixture of principles of tort and contract. Now, there used to be a principle of caveat emptor, that buyer be aware. Now, this doctrine held that the buyer should be totally responsible, although the seller was aware of the defect or deficiency. Now, it was this caveat emptor principle, which we find in Sale of Goods Act. This principle put the responsibility on the buyer to carry out all due diligence before buying anything. However, it was under Consumer Protection Act that this principle was liberalized, and it imposed the duty on the seller, manufacturer, or service provider to ensure that the customer is not cheated. Then rigid procedural requirements were also liberalized. Simple and easy methods to access of justice have been provided under Consumer Protection Act. So there are two kinds of consumer under this act. One is consumer of goods, another is consumer of services. Consumer of goods is one who buys or agrees to buy some goods, or any user of such goods, or person who is hires or avails any service, or any beneficiary of that service. So these are ones who are covered. Section 21D of Consumer Protection Act 1986 and Section 2, Subsection 7 of 2019 Act provide this definition. Now, under the Consumer Protection Act, it should be for your personal use only that you have availed the goods or services. If you have availed it for your business purpose, then it cannot be you cannot be considered as a consumer. However, a proviso has been given that if it is for your day-to-day earning or livelihood, then you definitely fall under the consumer. Now, take for an example that you have purchased a machinery. You are having 15-20 machineries and you are using it for your business, for production of goods and selling those goods. Then you do not fall in the definition of consumer so far as that machinery is concerned. But if you have only one printing press, which is only source of your livelihood, then you can say that I am having one machine only and that is the only source of my livelihood, and therefore you fall under the definition of consumer. So it's a wide definition. You can and cannot fall within that definition on the basis of the interpretation. So it is left to the courts to interpret that someone is a consumer or not. For example, if you have purchased an insurance policy, even if for your for protection of your factory premises, then you definitely fall within the definition of consumer, because that protects your interests as a person in that business, not the day-to-day affairs of business. So this is how you have to interpret the definition of consumer. So protection is to be given against what? So protection is to be given against unfair trade practice, restrictive trade practice, defect and deficiency. Defects would be in the goods and deficiencies would be in the services. So what is unfair trade practice? So unfair trade practice would mean adopting unfair methods or deception to promote sale, use or supply of goods or services. Then misleading public about the price, that is bargain price when it is actually not a bargain price. Charging above MRP which is printed. We used to see this very regularly in cinemas, airports. You know, MRP would be like 25 rupees, 30 rupees on a can of soda and you would be paying 100 rupees. So this was held to be illegal, and now they have their specially printed prices. The companies print separate prices for them and said, it is mentioned to be sold through special channel only. So they came out with their own solution to that problem. Then misleading public about another's goods or services. Recently, we had this issue of Dettol and Lifebuoy going to Bombay High Court, where Dettol for selling its product used the red soap of the Lifebuoy to show that that's not actually a good one. So Lifebuoy went to the Bombay High Court and they said that this should not have been done. You should not make misleading statements about our goods and services, and that's an unfair trade practice. And Bombay High Court somehow supported them. And Lifebuoy, in fact, another came with another advertisement. If you go to YouTube and you can search, so they came up with in public interest, use Dettol, Lux, Lifebuoy, or any other soap. So that would be a positive way of advertising your product, and no one can object to that, because they said that we are issuing it in public interest, that because in this times when soap is an essential thing to fight against the COVID-19 disease, you can use any soap, even though we do suggest you to use Lifebuoy, but Dettol, Lux, everything is equally good. So this is how something which is unfair, then, and what is something overly fair. Then falsely claiming a sponsorship or approval or affiliation. Sometimes you come across, institutes say that we are affiliated to so-and-so, we are affiliated to so-and-so university, which they actually are not. So claiming such sponsorships or approvals or affiliations is also unfair trade practice. Then offering misleading warranties or guarantees, that also falls under unfair trade practice. Then you have restrictive trade practice, where price fixing or output restraint in delivery flow of supplies to impose unjustified cost restrictions on consumers. This you must be facing right now in certain areas. You know, masks currently, they became a very, you know, essential commodity suddenly, the sanitizers. And people were charging like 100 rupees for a mask of 10 rupees. People were charging 250 rupees for a bottle of small bottle, 200 ml bottle of sanitizer. So government had to step in and fix the prices for masks and sanitizers. But what happened before that, the masks of 10 rupees was being sold for 30 rupees, even if MRP was mentioned as 10 rupees. And what was the reason given? That there is no flow of supplies. We are not getting the supplies. There is a shortage in the market. So this all comes within the definition of restrictive trade practice. When you are restricting the consumer from actually getting a product by giving false pretexts of flow of supplies or restrictions, then there is collusive tendering, market fixing. For example, if you have seen, there are certain things which are being sold in the market at a rate fixed by the government, but those rates are arrived at after tendering. For example, right now people are having the solar panels installed. Now, if you go to the website of MNRE, they have this benchmark price of 54 rupees per watt peak. Now, if you go to Gujarat government's website, we have the benchmark of from 46,000 to lowest to 42,000. That is 46 rupees to 42 rupees. Now, these prices are arrived at after tendering. But what if these companies, you know, come together, form a cartel and make a tendering process collusive? They can take the prices up to 60 rupees also, which were earlier the benchmark prices. I'm sorry. These collusive tendering in the market and market fixing, this is also restrictive trade practice. So government has to ensure that when they are doing this process, there is no collusion found within the persons who are participating in the tendering process, and to make sure that entire process goes smoothly, the interest of goods and services. Then supplying only to a particular distributor or on a condition of sale only within a territory. Now that also amounts to restrictive trade practice. That you don't sell it, you know, within only in these areas of Ahmedabad and not outside that. You know, people outside those territories should not have access to goods. So that becomes restrictive trade practice. Then delaying in supplying goods and services leading to rise in price. Now this is also which many of us would be facing right now, that people are holding back the goods, traders are holding back the goods and not supplying it, so that when their demand rises, they can ask for the prices of their choice, you know, keeping the goods. Now this cannot happen generally in perishable goods, but when it happens mostly in the essential goods, because for non-essential items, if it's not available, people are not going to say, okay, fine, I'm going to pay higher price. But now for essential things, if you are not getting them, it becomes difficult, and therefore you are ready to pay higher price. So this tool being used by the traders is considered to be restrictive trade practice. And then requiring a customer to buy or hire any goods or service as a precondition for buying or hiring other goods or service. That if you want to buy this, you need to buy this. If you don't buy this, I'm not going to give this. So that becomes restrictive. But these two products and services should be independent of each other. Now, for example, if someone says that if you want to buy our annual maintenance contract, you need to buy the goods. That can be a reasonable restriction, because we can only maintain something which we have sold. But I cannot say that if you want to buy this printer, you have to buy this laptop from me. That becomes restrictive. Now, for goods, we have the concept of defects. For services, we have the concept of deficiency. Now, what is defect? Any fault, imperfection, shortcoming in the quality, quantity, potency, purity, or standard, which is required to be maintained by or under any law for the time in force, or under any contract express or implied, or as is claimed by the trader in any manner whatsoever in relation to any goods. Now, these are the defects. That is generally shortcoming in quality, quantity, potency, purity, and standard, which is required to be maintained. Then there is deficiency in service. Service deficiency would mean fault, imperfection, shortcoming, or inadequacy in the quality. So when it can be said to be a deficient service, if there is a, now this is more, you know, relative in nature, whereas in defects are more standardized in nature. If you can, you can say that this is a defect by merely seeing it. Whereas deficiency is something which cannot be, you know, immediately by looking into something you can make out. It has to be, you know, from series of events that you have to come to a conclusion that this is deficiency. So what are the rights of the consumers? Right to safety against the hazardous goods and services. So first right is your right to safety. That hazardous goods and services should not be sold in the market so that the consumers are not affected. Then right to be informed about quality, quantity, purity, standard, and price. Now, whenever you buy a product, you know, even a soap or something, all the details are to be mentioned on that. A medicine, soap, an Ayurvedic medicine, whatever you buy. So, everything is mentioned on the cover. What's the quality? Quantity. Quantity means what grams, liters, milliliters, whatever should be the quantity. Then, purity. If any product which is being sold has some purity standard, then that purity standard has to be disclosed, that we are maintaining certain standards. If you are aware that, you know, certain services and products have some ISO standards which they are following, so they have to mention that they are following these standards, and then it's easy for consumer to look into those standards and check the product or service for those standards, whether they are actually being maintained or not. Then right to choose from a variety at a competitive prices. Now, what does that mean? You know, it should be an endeavor in any market that consumer has option of varieties. It's not that there is only one thing which we are being sold and we are not permitting any other thing to enter into that market, so that consumer has no choice or of option or competitive prices. Soaps are available from rupees 7 to rupees 700. So it's the choice of the consumer which product he wants to buy. But you cannot say that only the 700 rupees soap will be sold in this market and no other soap would be sold. Right? So it should be, the variety options should always be made available to the consumer, and it's the right of the consumer to choose from the variety at competitive prices. Then right to be heard. Right to be heard by whom? Here the right to be heard is by the producer of the goods or services, seller of the goods or services. If you are, you know, think you, if you think after buying a product, you have the right to be heard by the seller, by the producer. You know, good companies mention even on their products that in case of any complaints or suggestions, please mail us on this number or this email address. So they want to hear from their customers. And this right is actually a consumer right, which they are giving a platform to. Now, if you are not heard, then what you have? Then you have the right to seek redressal. Now, redressal means what? When you go to a third party where someone is, you know, sitting there to hear you and decide and give you a solution to your problem. So Consumer Protection Act provides for redressal through Consumer Forum, Consumer Commission and National Commission. And the last one is a right to consumer education. Now this right is to be ensured by the government. If you see on the TV regularly, we have these ads on radio, TV. At every frequency, we have this ad, Jago Grahak Jago. You know, they talk about consumer rights. They publicize about consumer rights. Now, this is how the consumer rights are to be. You know, consumer is to be educated about their rights. And they tell you, this is your right. If someone does this, you go to the court. If someone does this, if someone doesn't give you a bill, you can go to the court. If someone sells your product and, you know, charges you above MRP, you should go to the court. So what happens is, you know, consumer is being educated of their rights. And this education helps them to enforce their rights. So we talked about the redressal forums. So we have Consumer Dispute Redressal Forum, which is district forum, which right now can accept the claims less than or equal to rupees 20 lakhs. Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission, that is state commission, which has powers to accept the claims from 20 lakhs to 1 crore. And NCDRC, which have right to adjudicate the claims above rupees 1 crore. Now, Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission also has powers to hear the appeals against the orders of district forum. Similarly, National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission has powers to hear the appeals against the orders of state commission. And NCDRC appeal goes to the Supreme Court. Now, there is also provision for revisions. Certain orders which are not appealable under the Consumer Protection Act, those orders can be heard in revision. The revision for interference, but commission, state commission and national commission has power to hear revision petitions against the orders which are not appealable. So what is the requisites of filing of complaint or appeal? Who can file a complaint? So complaint can be filed by a consumer. Then that is the definition of complainant. Now, if we take up Consumer Protection Act 2019. In Consumer Protection Act 2019, a complainant can be a consumer, a voluntary consumer association, central government or state government, central authority, one or more consumers where there are numerous consumers having the same interest. In case of death of consumer, his legal heir or legal representative, and in case of consumer being minor, his parent or legal guardian. So they will be the complainant. Where to file a complaint? We discuss the three forums which are available. We discuss their pecuniary jurisdiction. So they have to go before the appropriate forum for filing of the complaint. Then how to file a complaint? So complaint has to be in writing. In writing means you have to give your details, the details of product and services. We will discuss this in the next slide also. Name and address of the complainant, name and address of opposite party, description of goods and services, quality, quantity, price, proof of purchase, then nature of deception. You know, there is deficiency, there is defect. What is the problem? You have to mention that in your complaint, and type of redressal prayed for. So this is how you have to file your complaint. Now, what constitutes a complaint? Complaint, as I said, you have to mention that what has aggrieved you. unless there is a grievance, there cannot be a complaint. So that has to be taken care of while drafting your complaint. And then procedure of filing appeal. Now appeal has to be against the order of the original forum. Suppose it's district forum, the appeal will go to the appellate court. But the details of parties and everything would be same. The only thing which will be added in the appeal would be details of how you are aggrieved by the order of the forum below. That is, if district forum, then state commission. If state commission, then national commission appeal will go to. But how you are aggrieved by the order of forum or state commission or the national commission if you go to the Supreme Court. That has to be mentioned. Now, what kind of reliefs can be granted? Now, this is a very important aspect. Relief would mean the relief to the consumer. The forum or the state commission or the national commission can order the removal of defects in goods or deficiency in services if it is possible. If not possible, then replacement of defective goods. If even that is not possible, suppose that product has been discontinued, then refund against the defective goods or deficient services. And compensation. Compensation can be for mental harassment. Compensation can be for, you know, damages caused because of the product or deficiency in services. Compensation can be for loss of, you know, time and efforts in the litigation. It can be in form of costs of litigation. Compensation can be in form of interest loss, right? So this all can be granted. And then prohibition on sale of hazardous goods. If consumer court or commission forum comes to a conclusion that this is a hazardous good, they can prohibit the sale of those goods. Then we have this Consumer Protection Act 2019. Now, all of you are aware that from past few years, 5-10 years, we have seen a rise in e-commerce transactions. What is e-commerce transaction? You all are aware. You all must be buying goods from Amazon, Flipkart, you know, other e-commerce platforms directly from the websites of the producers or sellers. Now, this gave a new challenge to the entire, you know, consumer protection laws. Earlier, the markets were perceived to be very, you know, small markets, very limited markets. That person will go at most to a shop which is in next city, located in the next city, a nearest city, to buy something. So under old Consumer Protection Act, there was issues of jurisdiction. Jurisdictions were imposed in a way that you have to file your complaint in the jurisdiction where the defendant resides or carries on business. Now what happened with e-commerce transactions? People started buying goods and services from, you know, other end of the country or even from some other countries. The manufacturer is somewhere else, seller is someone else. So 2019 Act tried to, you know, take into its periphery all the issues relating to e-commerce transaction. So consumers' definition was also taken up to make, you know, online purchases also part of this law. Then endorsements of goods and services normally done by celebrities is also now covered within the ambit of this act. This act has been given assent by the president, but it is not yet notified. So currently we are being covered by the old act, but this is which has been already received an assent passed by the both the houses parliament, received the assent of the president, and now it is yet to be notified. The rules have also been framed. Then we see Amitabh Bachchan, you know, endorsing certain goods. We see Deepika Padukone endorsing certain goods. We see other celebrities endorsing certain goods. Now, what if that is turns out to be hazardous? So this new act, you know, it places the responsibility even on the persons making endorsements of goods and services to be liable, that they should be first sure about what they are endorsing, and then only they should endorse it. So what this will help is it will prevent false and misleading advertisements. Then the definition of goods has also been amended to include food as defined in food and safety standards. So food delivery platforms like Swiggy, Zomato, they also now within the ambit of this new act. Then there is a new concept of product liability. Now what is product liability? Here the manufacturer is made liable for damage caused to a consumer because of defective product. Now there is one thing called defective product, and you know, your loss and damages were calculated only to the extent of the cost of that product. But certain products also causes other damages, other harms, which are not actually quantifiable on the basis of the cost of the product itself. So liability arising out of that product is also now covered. For example, if I buy something for like 10,000 rupees, but because of defect in that product, the damage caused to be me, that because that product didn't work properly, I lost a crore of rupees. So that will be considered to be a product liability, and manufacturer will be liable for that damage, subject to if I can prove it in the court. Then the concept of unfair contracts has been introduced. This again, you know, happens in, you know, when you buy something from the websites. After, you know, adding everything in cart, you go check out, then it says, I accept the terms and conditions, and you tick mark that. Now, accepting the terms and conditions would mean you have accepted the, you know, liability, everything which is mentioned. Now, these are generally, you know, unreasonable contracts, skewed contracts in the favor of manufacturer or service providers. But you have no other option. If you want to buy it, you have to accept it. You have no option to negotiate that. So under the new law, we have provisions dealing with these unfair contracts. Then definition of unfair trade practice has been enlarged to include electronic advertising, which is misleading. You know, certain companies, they don't advertise on TV, normal radios, and, you know, hoardings and everything. There is something called social media platform marketing and everything. Now, those advertising are also now included within unfair trade practices. Then it is now an offense if a personal information given in confidence and gathered in course of transaction gets disclosed. So this is for data privacy. Because when you are purchasing something and you are giving your personal information like your name, address, certain times you gave, you know, very, very personal information online. Now this, if gets disclosed to a third party, can cause you some damage, some loss of reputation. So the new act even protects you from that. Now what are more features of new act? Admissibility of complaint is to be decided in 21 days. Now there is a deeming provision in this, that if court doesn't decide whether the complaint is to be admitted or not within 21 days, it shall be deemed to be admitted. So it makes the timeline more stricter in comparison to the old act. Then the provisions for review are introduced. Earlier act did not have the provision for review. So everything once decided had to be challenged in appeal. But now the provisions for review has been introduced. So this will reduce the burdens of appeal. the pecuniary jurisdiction under the new act would be, as we discussed, under old act it was 20 lakhs, now it is 1 crore. State commission, it used to be 20 lakhs to 1 crore. Now it is 1 crore to 10 crores. And national commission, above 10 crores. Now this also sets up the Consumer Protection Authority, Central Consumer Protection Authority. Now this is the first time that there is a regulatory authority for consumer rights which has been set up under this act. And this regulatory authority will be headed by a director general of, you know, Consumer Protection Authority. And that director general will be heading an investigative wing, which will conduct inquiries and investigation into any violation of consumer rights, unfair trade practices, or misleading advertisements. And the earlier act did not have such a provision for a regulator. What are new features? Complaints can be filed online. Still, we don't have the platform, but this has to be put in place before this act is notified. Hearing can be sought through video conferencing. This we all are doing now, even in the High Court, Supreme Court, and District Courts during this COVID-19 period. But then this has to be introduced under the new act. Issues of jurisdiction have been resolved. E-commerce transaction, even where the buyer resides, is now having the jurisdiction only of the will decide the jurisdiction of the court. So the conclusion, this act will replace the Consumer Protection Act 1986 once it is notified by central government. This will have the rules have been framed under this act, the concept of product liability, this all we have already discussed, and the regulator also we discussed in the previous slides. So I will now open this up for any questions if we have. Where are the manage points?
There is a question in chat box asked by Anand.
Just a second. I will unmute all also. I have unmuted everyone. So I will just the chat for a moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sir, but even today you see advertisements of magical and tantric services to resolve problems of people. Please comment. So file a complaint. That's the answer. Pick up the, if you find something like that, I've not come across that, but if you come across that, you should immediately file a complaint. And that is also an offense under the another act of this magical prohibition of magical.
So sir, you see such kind of advertisements on newspapers every day. I actually see them every day.
If you see them, see, we also have the advertisements of, you know, prohibited services in newspapers every day, the small column ones and everything.
Yeah, exactly.
These are misleading and everything. We do see misleading advertisements like, you know, earn 50,000 per month and, you know, the people are misled into and defrauded. Complaints are also being filed against them. But most of the problem is that consumers don't, you know, go to the court. Don't, you know, they feel that going to court is much more burdensome than, you know, taking a remedy under the, you know, they are ready to forego what they have lost. So we need people to file complaints. That's the thing, and therefore this new act. Then I will have to mute everyone again, and those who want to ask questions can. Sorry, because I am hearing some side talks also. So those who are, those who have to ask questions, they can unmute themselves. So what I was saying was that if you see certain advertisements like that, you should file a complaint. Take on yourself. You can even now invoke the, once the new act is, you can invoke the central authority for such investigations. Any other question or something we have?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
As you said, when there are tenders, for contracts.
Right.
So now there is a new system of e-tendering,
right,
in which the tender amount and the, what do you say, the quotations are not shared.
Not shared.
Sorry.
They are not even known to the authority.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
So, sir, how do you, when, see, there are people in the same business who have been working for 40, 50
That's
years.
That's what I said. Therefore, I shared the example of this solar tendering. Now, this tendering is not actually for something which government is buying. Government is only a party which is subsidizing the process. But they have to fix a rate. The rate fixing happens on the basis of the tenders received. They take the average of, you know, lowest like 15%, yeah, and then they take up the cost of the tendering, and that becomes the cost for the consumer.
Now, but the same is not, but the same is not possible for roads and buildings.
That is also possible for them. For them also now, because e-tendering has made the process more transparent.
But see, sir, earlier there used to be this system of rings. Mm-hmm. If you know what I mean, it's a slang in Gujarati, right? Before tendering, we all gather at the same place and decide that they pay each other off.
Correct. But what happens is
that is still possible even today.
That is what I am saying. So that there comes the role of the government and the regulator in the, so far as protection of rights of consumer are concerned. They have to ensure that this doesn't happen.
And if it happens,
we have these things called global tenders now.
Yeah,
are being floated. So that, you know, you somehow take out the local factor. Okay, bhai, ahya Ahmedabad na 8 contractor chane ek bhega mali ne decide kare ne.
Exactly, sir. Huh?
So that cannot happen if you have something called global tender. E-tendering has made that thing now to an extent, you know, it has been reduced.
And sir, if I myself have not been wrong,
I came across one tender of Gujarat Maritime Board. Mm-hmm. Now earlier they used to have this tender locally, and you know, for ferry services across certain points, and there were only one and two participants who were participating. Even this Bhavnagar Ro-Ro ferry was also, you know, part of that. Now, what happened? They started this e-tendering process. And in e-tendering, this time, there was a tender for ferry between Dwarka and Okha. And that tender could not succeed because of the conditions placed by the GMB. But there were participants right from West Bengal, Mumbai, Kerala, who had participated. They didn't have this option of, you know, sitting together within a 5-star hotel in Ahmedabad and deciding the rates amongst themselves. Ke bhai jene pan tender made, we will be operating it together. This used to happen.
Yes.
So you, by use of information technology and certain platforms, this can be taken care of, and governments are doing their best for that.
And sir, if I am not personally wronged by such an act, can I still file a complaint against these people if something like this has happened?
This Central Consumer Protection Authority will have, you know, jurisdiction even to look into such complaints.
Okay. Even if I am not wrong, they have.
Yes. Even if you are not wrong, yes.
Jurisdiction. That's about it from me, sir. Thank you.
One from product liability on supply. Yes, of course. Even the new act provides a product liability that arises from the impact of the goods that you have purchased. We have any other question or something? Some feedback?
Sir, Ronak is also having some questions. Ronak?
Yeah, he said about strict liability.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, he asked something.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, I answered that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Anyone else? I think one. Thank you so much, sir. On behalf of the Marwad University Faculty of Law, I thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Maybe you can share the recording with me also.
Yeah, sir. Definitely.
Yeah.